Bem-vindo a todos para pode ser que vai ser o último seminário desse semestre. Hoje nós temos a honra e o prazer de ter a Alberica Toia. Ela estudou na Universidade de Milão, na Itália, mas no fim concluiu o bacharelado, a graduação dela no Instituto Niels Bohr da Holanda, e depois fez um mestrado em Milão, e o doutorado em Gießen, na Alemanha, onde ela trabalhou no experimento Hades, no laboratório GSI. Depois ela foi postdoc no Stony Brook University na Nova York, trabalhando no esperimento de Phoenix no RIC, onde, incidentalmente, o gruppo de Unicamp trabalhou no passato, junto a Carrasco, se lembro bem. Depois ela foi no CERN, no gruppo de Alice, e agora ela sta trabalhando de volta no laboratorio de GSI, no esperimento che stanno costruendo ora e di che ela vai falar oggi. Os interesses da pesquisa dela sono as condições da matéria, a densidade e a temperatura extremas. Como sempre, vai ter uma lista de presença que eu vou pôr no chat. Vai ter pergunta, se você tem uma pergunta urgente, pode pôr no chat, mas depois claramente vai ter perguntas. Alberica, thank you very much for coming to speak to us. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much, Giorgio, for the nice introduction, which I almost could guess what you said. And thank you all for hosting me. I'm very pleased to be with you, although I cannot say here with you, but that's how things are at the moment. So I will be happy to present you what are the plans and the goals in general of the future facility for antiproton and ion research fair in Germany. What we want to do, exploring the cosmic matter in the laboratory, and in particular with the CBM experiment, compressed baryonic matter, which aims to study high density nuclear matter, the equation of state, and investigate the QCD phase diagram. So I will start with the stars and what we know about their evolution from young stars to the most strange and exciting objects that we have in the universe, namely neutron stars and eventually black holes, which have recently got a lot of attention because they were photographed, black holes were photographed for the first time last year. And we also got new insights from gravitational waves about neutron stars and neutron stars merging. But so let's start from the beginning. What stars are essentially hydrogen.
Alberica, just one thing.
Sure.
Maybe you can put it's showing the whole window with the slide pane and stuff like this. Are you sure you don't want to put it in presentation mode?
I thought I am in the presentation mode. Let me just.
Sure.
Okay.
I mean, it's okay, it's visible. With presentation mode, it will be bigger, that's all. Yes.
Okay, so we even started the recording again. So then
Yes.
let's restart from young
Now you're
stars
on slide two. Yeah, now
that
you're on slide
made
two. Yeah.
of hydrogen, and with nuclear reaction they convert hydrogen into helium, and then into helium into carbon, and carbon into oxygen, and so on and so forth. With simultaneously they produce heat and energy, and that's why we see the stars brightening in the sky. And as long as the radiation balances the gravity, the life of stars goes on, but once we reach iron, then nuclear fusion stops because it's not convenient any longer for the stars to make a nuclear reaction and so to fuse elements, but the energy is not enough. So at that point, what happens is that the stars has a very different layers with a massive core made of iron and the external layers made of lighter and lighter elements. At that point, the massive core collapse. And this collapse is so sudden that what happens with the outer layers is that they are blown out completely in fractions of a second. This creates a shockwave which produces the extremely famous supernova explosion. Super famous because they have been visible and they have been observed even in the past when these objects were not known at all. Now the result of this is a neutron star, which is the remainder of the old star after all the outer layers have exploded. And at this point, what remains is just the core that is essentially the densest and tiniest object that we can observe in the universe. The radius is only about 10 to 16 kilometers, while the mass can reach up to 2 solar masses. So it's an extremely dense matter, such that if all the people in the world would be condensed in a spoon of coffee, this would be the same density as in a neutron star. The magnetic field of the neutron star is huge. The gravity is many, many times what we experience on Earth. And they also spiral around up to some 100 times per second. A merger of two neutron stars is what happens when two stars happen to orbit because of gravity onto each other. And at some point they attract for gravity much more and much more until they start merging and melting, leading to the creation of even more massive neutron stars or black holes, if the mass is even larger. The melting creates a huge magnetic field and a short gamma ray burst, which goes under the name of kilonova. This is a transient source of isotropic long wave radiation that happens because of the simultaneous emission of light in various wavelengths, and all also accompanied with neutrinos. These events were actually now observed with gravitational waves, but also with a network of telescopes all pointing to the place where the event happened, so that it was possible to record all the emission over a long range of time, various days, weeks. Now, to study this matter on Earth is obviously impossible because we don't have it in hand. On the other hand, it is extremely interesting and extremely fascinating because this kind of matter is nuclear matter, but under extreme conditions. So we are all familiar what means studying matter under different phases. We are all familiar with what means studying, for example, the phase diagram of water. We know that we experience water under liquid, gas, solid state here on Earth. We know that by varying the temperature and the pressure, we can vary the state. but what it means in terms of nuclear matter. To access these states is not something that we can easily control in a tabletop experiment. On the other hand, we have an extremely powerful tool that are, in general, heavy ion collisions. Here in the bottom, I show a cartoon of what a general heavy ion collision would mean. We bring nuclei, typically heavy nuclei, colliding onto each other. We choose heavy nuclei so that we have a large number of neutrons and protons, and we smash them at velocity close to speed of light. Because of this high velocity, you see the nuclei here squeezed as pancakes rather than what they would be at rest as normal balls. And then when they compenetrate, they start to form and to free their interior components, so the quarks and gluons. And then this fireball created at the beginning expands and rapidly reaches our detectors. It's a very important tool because we can control both the species of ions, of nuclei that we use, and the energy, so the velocity they travel. And by changing this, we have an experimental knob to explore the phase diagram in different regions. We start to look at it at very high temperature in this region where LHC and previously RIC have measured a lot. This is the region where at relatively low biochemical potential, the conditions are similar to the situation of the early universe. Here we observe, when the temperature is high, a region dominated by quarks and gluons. And then when the system expands and cools, it reaches the condition of normal nuclear matter, which sits down here. The transition is smooth, has no discontinuities nor change of symmetries, so it's rather a crossover and is indicated here. In contrast, the region, this region of phase space is now very much explored with lots of experiments, namely ALICE, ATLAS, CMS at LHC, but was also previously explored a lot with all the experiments at RIC, STAR, Phoenix, and the others. The region, in contrast here, at relatively lower temperature and high baryon density, is what is resembles the conditions of the interior of neutron stars, or even the conditions that one would see in a merger of neutron stars. And this region was historically studied with early on with experiments at GSI, but also later at AGS in Brookhaven, or the early experiments at CERN with the lower energy accelerators. And now it recently got a lot of attention with future programs of like FAIR, but also in Dubna, and also the experiments at RIC, particularly STAR, tries to go down as low as possible in energy, and even tried to measure in fixed target. So from collider moved to fixed target mode to further reduce the square root of S of the collision. You see here in this bottom panel, the conditions of hydrochemical freeze-out that all these experiments have reached. and they seem to map what is known theoretically from as a region of phase transition. There should be a point where the first order phase transition observed at large chemical potential and the region of crossover observed at low chemical potential and high temperature meet. And this is a critical point. And this is the object of various investigations. In this other region, where theoretical guidance is actually also less obvious because it's more difficult to apply lattice QCD to calculate perturbatively the possible properties of matter. It may even be that there are a splitting of the chiral transition and the confinement transition, which open up space to a so-called quarkionic matter where hadrons are not deconfined, but though chiral symmetry is restored. And if we now allow also a third axis on this diagram, also considering strange matter has yet another degree of freedom, and therefore the situation becomes more interesting and at the same time more unexplored. If we look at what we can expect at CIS-100, we see that the prediction indicate that the trajectory of the matter produced would go in the region far beyond normal nuclear density, and therefore really being able to access this region of quark hadron mixed phase, where many things may lead to discoveries and may give us information to what we would be able to observe in neutron stars. Now, here is a sketch of the FAIR facility for antiproton and ion research, and in which is all those lines indicated in red, together with the currently existing facility, which is the blue one. So it's a huge project, probably one of the largest worldwide upgrade of a facility, which goes to the forefront research in many fields of nuclear hadron, atomic, but also plasma physics and applied physics. I will try to tell you a little bit of all those programs, but okay, its path has been a bit of long adventure. It was proposed various years ago, but it was only in July 2017 that we started the excavation with a nice ceremony groundbreaking here on 4th of July 2017. And then at the moment the construction are going on, and we expect the facility completed in 2025, starting operation then. It is financed partly from Germany, partly from the state of Essen, where we are, and partly of various other countries, among which Germany, Russia, India, Poland, Romania, etc., etc. What we can expect are heavy ion, let's say gold ions from which go, let's say, in square root of S up to 4.7 GeV, light ions going a little bit higher, and also protons. So what is very unique of now of GSI and in the future facility also, is the capability of accelerating really every ion species, including nuclei like uranium. And the other strong point of this facility is the intended intensity, which goes really up to the frontier. The current existing UNILAC and CIS-18 would be used as injectors for the biggest tunnel of CIS-100. This is about 1 kilometer circumference. It is built, and we build all the experiment in a way that they can also run with CIS-300 if it would ever exist. And here you see where the compressed baryonic matter experiment would sit and all the other experiments that would sit around here. I will mention them now in the next few slides. So here I want to show you some picture starting from the groundbreaking I just mentioned. But now the situation of this was, I think it's about a year ago or more, which really gives the good picture of how the facility would look like. The tunnel is currently being excavated, and now here we can show more. It would go 17 meters below ground. This is a recent picture, and here you can see all how the inside of the tunnel would look like. The experimental program is, as I said, very broad. So it's not only heavy ion physics, but all in all the programs aim at studying this kind of cosmic matter. NuSTAR tries to study, we discussed before, the life of a star up to iron, where nuclear reactions stop. But on the other hand, we know on Earth many more elements. Where do they come from, and how do they how they are produced, and how why are some elements produced and some other are very rare? This is what this NuSTAR program aims to study. And the way to study is that they produce heavy elements, and they select them with a superfragment separator that has a series of magnets to select the fragments based on their mass time of flight. And then the fragments are stored in storage rings and measured, so that they can be measured many times. And in this way, they aim to measure mass, lifetime, decay channels, structures of very rare and unstable nuclei. We have the PANDA experiment that is an experiment in that aims to use antiprotons. Antiprotons would also be produced and stored to be then collided with protons. In this way, the annihilation of proton and antiproton essentially allows to create all the possible quantum numbers, and therefore study all objects expected and predicted by QCD, which are rare or difficult to be observed. Gluonic excitation, charmonium states, but also pentaquarks. All these exotic objects can be accessed and can be measured. So in fact, the discovery potential is really a lot. Next, we have a program which includes a lot of experiments in atomic plasma physics and applied physics that is very broad, goes from biophysics research, which is extremely interesting and important also for medical applications, because it uses our accelerator to bombard tumor cells in a way that is much more precise and effective than a traditional radiation, because it really deposits the energy just on the tumor cells without destroying the neighboring tissues. This goes for tumors that are in difficult regions or that are not treatable in any other way, but also goes to the frontier of trying to diagnose and so to image the tumor at the same time as it is treated. Other studies include material science, so studying which are the materials which would best fit or how materials tolerate radiations. This is important, for example, for aerospace applications. And in fact, there is a large collaboration with the Space Agency. But now let me tell you something more about our experiment, the compressed baryonic matter, CBM, and its physics case and the observables we are interested in. So CBM is a traditional, let's say, or a general avion experiment that, however, in contrast to many others, has as a target the observation of rare observables. And this is because first of all, because, as I said before, collision energy, low collision energy were available many years ago. On the other hand, the detectors and the accelerator facility were not so advanced as they are today, and many observables were not measured or poorly measured. Now we have to profit at all of the incredible interaction rates that our accelerator can give us, and therefore CBM sits here, really at the frontier of interaction rate capable of being measured. For this reason, becomes available all the measurement of rare probes, like multi-strange hyperons, hypernuclei, CHARM, dileptons, all those measurements that require either an infinite amount of time to measure or very high interaction rates. We see here that many facilities, many experiments now turned into this region of lower energies, among that NA61 at SPS CERN, BMA10 and the experiments at Jinner and Dubna, but also the STAR, both in fixed target and in with the beam energy scan. Up here are, of course, the experiments at RIC and LHC. If we want to run at this incredible intensity of up to 10 megahertz, 10 megahertz really means 10 million events per second, so it's really a lot. This poses a lot of requirements on how to build the experiment. The detector and the electronics have to be radiation hard, first of all, in order to survive, also have to be fast to be able to read everything that comes from a collision. On the other hand, not everything can be taped, so we have to make a choice of what to record and what to throw away. And this has to be done online, because we cannot afford to tape it. If we have to do it online, then we have to see what are the observables that we are interested in, and those observables do not have a simple trigger concept. So what we are forced to do is really to examine the complete event, all the products of a collision. And by collision, we really mean central gold-gold collisions that produce all those track density that you see depicted here. This is about 1,000 particles per event, up to about 1,000 particles per event. And if we want to find a multi-strange hyperon here, we have to be able to determine its vertex, displaced vertex. We have to be able to identify all the decay products, and we have to be able to then select it. All those requirements impose us that we have to operate the detector in a free streaming mode, so without a trigger, but letting the electronic run all the time and essentially record all what comes and perform the event selection online in a sort of 4D event reconstruction, where the fourth dimension is the time. This changes a little bit the concept of a standard measurement from, let's say, taking a picture of the collision, as you can see it, for example, here in this simulated event display, to a sort of a movie of the collision. The detector, that's how a rendering of the detector looks like. It's a general multi-purpose heavy ion detector, and I will point you to the specifications that we now have because of the demands of our measurements. As we said, is a fixed target. The beam comes from here. Here you see the beam pipe, and this blue structure here is the magnet, a superconducting dipole magnet of one Tesla meter field. This bends the particle in a way that we can measure their momentum. Inside the magnet, we find first the microvertex detector that is used to determine the vertex, the displaced vertex of the collision, and therefore to look for weak decays. After that, the silicon tracking system, comprising of 8 stations of double-sided silicon sensor, is the main detector for tracking and momentum determination, but it can also do particle identification using the specific energy loss in a thin material. After that, we have these two detectors that can be used alternating, either the ring imaging Cherenkov detector for electron identification, discriminating electrons from pions, or the muon chamber system that is used for measuring muons, with various layers of absorber and tracking stations. For this, we use GEM detectors or RPCs, or the last station of the transition radiation detector, that is the next detector that comes, and that is used for enhancing the discrimination of electrons and pions, but also to measure light nuclei, also with the energy loss. This large time of flight wall is used, is made of resistive RPCs, and is used to identify hadrons, combining the measurement of the time of flight with the momentum that has been determined. And finally, we have here the projectile spectator detector that is a forward 0 degree essentially calorimeter that is used for measuring projectiles, so non-interacting nucleons, and therefore determining the centrality or the event and the event plane of the collision. The signal from all these detectors goes to our first level event selector, a huge computing farm that you see partially built already here, where the data is online analyzed and then selected. Here you see again the display of how a central collision at our or close to top energy would look like. And all these trajectories here are the particles that are produced in a central collision and that we want to measure. For reaching the goal of our experimental program, we want to be able to track them all with a high efficiency and an excellent momentum resolution below 2%. Because we have this high interaction rate implies that we don't only have to match or follow the trajectories of the particle in space, but we also have to do it in time and be able to separate events that practically, when the interaction rate grows so much, also overlap in time. You see here some simulations of what we expect for the performance of our reconstruction, and you see that for momentum larger than half a GeV, we essentially are already in the plateau for all primary tracks, and we are really reaching high efficiency as expected. And you also see that the momentum resolution is excellent, down to, again, half a GeV. Particle identification is achieved using our various the combination of our detectors, primarily for hadrons. You see what we can expect here for pion kaon protons. This is improved for electron identification using the reach. And if one uses, in addition, the transition radiation detector with its specific energy loss, one can nicely reconstruct light nuclei, well visible here in different bands. Also, the silicon tracking system, although has limited capability for measuring the energy loss, can help to distinguish those fragments that are not distinguishable based on their time of flight because they have the same MZ ratio. This is very important, for example, when one wants to go and search for hypernuclei in their decay. And now I want to mention a couple of observables that are our, let's say, most important or first observables that we would look like to show the capability of our detector in that field. Let's start with the flow that is very important because it can constrain the equation of state in a similar way as it can be done from astrophysical measurements. From astrophysics, we access the mass and the radius of neutron stars. But if we believe that the matter of neutron stars is similar to what we have produced in lab, and if we believe that the physics in the lab is the same as the physics in the stars, we should be able to constrain it as well as from the heavy ion collision. And in fact, the early measurements at AGS in the beam energies from 2 to 11 AGV produced already the so-called heavy ion constraint for the equation of state. For this one needs to measure the flow, and the way to quantify it is analyzing the azimuthal distribution, dnd phi, of the produced particles relative to the reaction plane. As you see here depicted, the interaction fireball is has this elongated almond shape as a consequence of the overlap of the two incoming nuclei. And the way particles are produced and emitted out of this fireball indicates how the collective motion inside the fireball, so early on in the evolution of the products of the collision, develops. Now, this is decomposed in a Fourier decomposition as shown here, and where this psi reaction plane is the reaction plane of the collision, and the coefficient V1, V2, Vn are the flow coefficient. And here you see the measurements done, a collection of measurements, which covers a large range of square root of S. And in the red box, the region of that can be accessed with the SIS-100. You see that in this, first of all, in this region is where things start to have a non-smooth behavior. And where the measurements have large statistical and systematic uncertainty. Here, we believe that CBM has a lot of potential exactly because of the tools we have, large interaction rate and modern detectors with excellent momentum resolution and large azimuthal coverage. In fact, you see here in a performance study what would be our capability for measuring V1 of protons, and in comparison with the input model, CBM is able to retrieve the original information very well. Multistrange hadrons have also a huge potential for telling us something about the equation of state. This would be the mechanism to produce them. However, if you look at the threshold energy, you may conclude that some of them are not accessible for us. That we are already sub-threshold. However, it could also be that hyperons are produced in multiple collisions. So in a way that using the energy of the system builds up sufficiently large energy to produce a hyperon that otherwise would be sub-threshold. This, of course, depends on the density of the system. And therefore, observing this, these particles at all would already indicate what the equation of state of that matter might be. If you look at measurements of strange and multi-strange hyperons here over a large range of square root of s, you see in the black shaded region where we would be able to measure, and you see that the interaction rates, the high interaction rate is really required in order to measure it. You see also that when going down to down in energy, the particles that otherwise look very much well described by a statistical hadronization model, assuming that all particles are in equilibrium, start to not be in equilibrium at all. As you can see, for example, here in this recent measurements from ADES, where the Xi minus is off from the model prediction by almost 25 times. And in fact, looking at a prediction for AGV gold, you see also that depending upon having a soft or a hard equation of state, the yield of strange and multi-strange hyperons would change a lot. Also, having chiral symmetry restoration would implies for some models, for example, PHSD, a large difference in the expected yield of those particles. So measuring them would bring a lot, especially the Xi and the Omegas, the data available from past experiment is really poor, almost non-existing. Here in, again, a performance plot of from a CBM simulation shows the reconstruction of Xi minus, and you can observe the excellent signal to background ratio. This would be just 5 million events, so for the rates expected in CBM is really a measurement that can be performed easily. Hypernuclei is something extremely nice and exotic, and is essentially a dream at these energies. Hypernuclei are nuclei which have at least one hyperon in addition to the normal protons and neutrons, and have been observed in 1952 for the first time with the nuclear emulsion technique. You see it shown here in this plot. How can they be produced? They can be either produced with a direct strangeness exchange reaction, or with the nucleus capturing a lambda or a kaon. And then again, their existence and their yield would say a lot about the density and the condition of the medium. It is conjectured that hypernuclei fill the core of neutron stars, because it's otherwise very hard to understand how this large density may exist with normal nuclear matter, because of the exclusion principle. While if one adds the strangeness quantum number, this is not restricted anymore, and then you can expect that matter can be packed much more. But this would tell us a lot about the strength of lambda nucleon interaction that does exist inside the core of neutron stars, and that we would be able to measure in the lab if we are able to access Kuiper nuclei. Looking at the expectations of hypernuclei as a function of square root of S, and looking at where we sit with CIS-100, that's why I said it's a dream measurement, because we are really in the place, in the best place to be. It's the maximum expected yield, and we are with the maximum interaction rate, and we have all the tools to measure them, namely the tracking, the displaced vertex, and the particle identification. So for this, we believe that our simulation that you can see here show a very good extraction for lambda hypernuclei, and that the signal to background ratio is really excellent. With this and using our high interaction rate capabilities, we believe we are not only able to perform the measurements of the yield only, but also of the lifetime and eventually of their collective flow, which would tell us a lot, because we know that flow is built in the early fireball, and by measuring the flow of hypernuclei with compared to the bulk of the particles, we would be able to access also information about the time and the temperature where they are produced. And finally, the thermal radiation is very important to determine the condition of temperature of the fireball produced. So this is really the only direct measurement of the temperature that we have, which is almost no model dependent, or has the least dependency. This is done now very well at CIS-18 with the Hades detector dedicated to the measurement of dileptons, where gold-gold collision at around one AGV has been measured extensively. And here you see a plot of compared to the reference of nucleon-nucleon reaction. You see that there is a large excess of dileptons produced. After subtracting the contribution of all expected hadronic sources, one can reconstruct a almost shapeless thermal spectrum that gives indication about the temperature of the source produced. Dileptons are extremely powerful because, in contrast to all hadrons, they do not interact strongly. So they really carry the information of the space in time, space-time point where they have been produced. And therefore, they are not just a thermometer, but also a chronometer of the evolution of the fireball. Here you see a performance plot of what we can expect from CBM in a central gold-gold collision at 10 AGV. CBM has two detectors that are able to measure dileptons. One is the setup, which includes the reach, which measures electrons, but we also have the muon chambers to measure dimuons. And this is very important to provide comparison and to measure both channels with completely different systematics and completely different eventually also rates, because muon can go extremely fast. And with this, one can even hope to access the charm spectrum maybe not in gold-gold collisions, but in P-gold or PP collisions, which can go to higher energy. With this, we hope to be able to measure the excitation function of dileptons, which does not have any measurement in the range from Hades to NA60, and where we see one may expect a jump, a discontinuity, but where the data already indicate a large difference of temperature. Now, we expect to be able to start the operations in 2025. In the meantime, we have various developments going on, which include various of our detectors and prototypes, which can run either at us at GSI or in other facilities, which allows us to collect experience with the detector, to test it, to improve it, and to participate in the physics program. For example, various photomultipliers of our reach have been installed in Hades. But also the time of flight has been installed and is already running in STAR at BNL, some modules of our time of flight detector. We have a collaboration with BMETN in Dubna to produce some station of the silicon tracking system and to use them in the gold beams up to 4.5 AGV. And we also have a collaboration that involves our projectile spectator detector, both with BMETN and with the NA61 SHINE experiment at the CERN SPS. And this has already been tested and has already run there. But another important, we call it FAIR phase zero experiment, is our so-called mini CBM. MCBM. This consists of prototypes and small parts of each of our detector that run together, and it is installed in a small cave. You can see here a picture of the first setup that ran in 2018. So it is really small as compared to the real CBM. But however, it has all the detectors and all the electronics and all the data acquisition that are expected to run in the real CBM. And this is extremely valuable for us because it resembles exactly the characteristics and the specification that we expect in the final CBM, and gives us very important tools to diagnose and resolve problems. We started running it in 2018, and we ran it last year in COVID time, and we are running it right now, and up to July with all restrictions that we have at the moment. But what we could already test and verify is the data transport of all subsystems in a common synchronized data stream. We could run and sustain beam intensities up to 10 to the 8 ions per second with collision rate of 10 megahertz for silver-silver. So we have reached essentially conditions of real CBM. And we could read and tape a peak rate of 2.5 gigabytes per second. So we are really happy of this setup, and we look forward to the beam time of this summer. So this brings me to the summary. I hope that I gave you an impression of the CBM physics program, the high precision studies of QCD phase diagram in the region, I would not say unexplored, but poorly explored of high net baryon densities, which may lead to new discoveries, but for sure to better pin down of this cosmic matter. We have unique measurements of rare diagnostic probes. We will measure all the standard bulk observables, and on top of that, we expect good measurements of collective effects, event by event fluctuation, multi-strange hyperons, dileptons, hypernuclei, and hopefully charm. The key requirements, the high rate capabilities, so fast and radiation hard detectors, electronics and data acquisition, and online event reconstruction, event selection. And the status looks promising, and we hope to have soon nice data to show. So I conclude. I thank you very much. It's still a bit difficult to interact online, but
thank you. No, thank you very, very much for this talk. Any questions? Please just raise your hand or unmute yourself if no one is speaking. Preguntas? I guess while people are waiting, I have a question. Can you bring back the slides?
I knew I should not have stopped it.
You mentioned at some point, right before you started talking about hypernuclei, you mentioned at some point that multi-strange particles are suppressed by a factor of like 25. Yeah, here. This was, maybe it was the pre, no, I think it's this one. This was a, yeah, this one here. This is a statistical model, or this is a kinetic model?
Sorry?
This is a statistical model.
Yes.
The calculation is a statistical model, right?
Yes.
And is it, this is not, there is no canonical suppression or anything like this here,
no,
right?
No.
Okay, so this is, wait, so this is the grand canonical statistical model.
Exactly, and this is that it works very nicely to describe essentially all energies.
Yeah.
However, when going down to the energy of, this is data from Hades, square root of S is 2.6, so it's around here, and it starts to break down for multi-strange, the cascade.
The reason I was asking is, you know, there was this big controversy for higher energies and small system sizes between people like my former advisor, who said that this is chemistry and it has to do with the phase transition. So there is a higher density of strange quarks, and people who said that this is conservation laws and away from the thermodynamic limit. So does this, and it's interesting that it's this thing here, does this thing add anything to this controversy or not? I mean, are we expecting this to be far away from the thermodynamic limit? Is it's only the Xi, which is It's only the Xayo which is suppressed, right?
It is only the Xayo. On the other hand, it is only the Xayo that contains more than one S quark.
Yes. Well, there is the Phi as well, and the Phi is not suppressed.
This is true. On the other hand, Phi is...
Okay. Okay, the question, I guess eventually threshold, if you go down enough in energy, you will see threshold effects that that it's impossible to create the Xi by one collision.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I mean, looking at this other plot, you see that all the particles have to have a threshold, and suddenly when you start to go into this region, you do expect criticalities. Yeah. And this is exactly the region where since the production cross section is so low, it becomes extremely difficult or almost impossible to measure. So this is why it's extremely important to have the possibility of being able to measure them if they exist, so that you can really pin down whether you are subthreshold and you do not produce it, or you are subthreshold and still manage to produce it out of the energy of the system, because then you learn something on the system density.
Of course. Mileto?
Okay, thanks for the conference. I refer to slide 22. For you, what is the cause of the excess of the leptons compared to the non-hadronic generators in the collision O plus O Athena AGV?
So what we see is that calculation with collisional broadening of the rho describe very well the data. And this is observed through all the energy that have measured the leptons so far. So this indicates a thermal rho production, or a thermal, essentially, then rho oscillating in the vacuum and then producing virtual, decaying into virtual photons that are then our dileptons. And this having the rho an extremely short lifetime gives the thermal character of this curve here.
I have a follow-up question about this, because this is something that I spent some time in my life arguing. There were people, there are many theorists who say, oh, the broadening of resonance is an experimentally observable fact, but also at higher energies. I mean, you know this because when you actually look at sort of the resonance, you always see a vacuum thing on top of an enhancement. You do not actually see a broader resonance.
Yes.
I've never seen an experimental set of data where you see a resonance shape which is different from the particle data book, which is different from a width of a particle data book. It's always continuums, enhancements, pedestrals, and so on and so forth. And then you fit it in a model which includes 20 different things, and it fits, but you don't see a direct evidence for broadening. Is that fair or not?
I would agree with that statement. I also don't see very much the difference of collinium, or the reasoning why collinium broadening rather than exciting the vacuum and therefore producing a broad spectrum.
Well, no. Hang on. A broad spectrum is if you guys fit the invariant mass histogram and find the width which is significantly higher than the particle data book. That's what I would call a broadening.
Okay, no.
Yeah, I have never seen it done. I'm not an expert. I've never seen something like this done.
No, I think that even NA60 data that were extremely precise, they always managed to observe a vacuum rho on top of
Something which doesn't have
something. I don't have to say a broadened rho.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm just saying that this...
A, rather shapeless spectrum.
For now, broadening is something theorists do. It's not something that experiment. So I was going to ask if you think that CBM, I mean, assuming this is really what is happening, is it possible for CBM to measure broadening, defined as the way I just defined it? You know, you fit a histogram and you measure a Breitwigner or something which is wider than the particle data book.
Okay, the signal to background is in this measurement is of course the killer. The background is extremely high, so I think we do have the resolution to see the resonances. Observing resonance plus broadening, this is probably goes beyond. Yes, but for sure, the enhancement is something that would be very well accessible.
Because the origin of the enhancement does not have to be broadening. There is all kinds of things that can give you a plateau in the background. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, I would be really careful at calling it broadening, right?
Yeah.
Further questions? Further questions? Take one, take two. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was
thank
very
you
nice
very
to
much.
Be with you.
Yeah. We'll be hearing a lot.
I wish
more of
we
this
will
stuff.
Be able to see each other soon.
We will.
When the world will be better.
Yes, I will stop recording. Yeah.